Good afternoon. Thank you for coming. I'm Rich Smeyne. I'm a professor of neuroscience at Thomas Jefferson University in Philadelphia. I also work in their director of their Parkinson's Center. I'm going to be talking about really burrowing down a little bit on the neuroanatomical effects of isolation. As Michael mentioned, we've been working together and collaborating since 2005, studying the effects of environmental enrichment and the role of exercise in neuroprotection. And as Michael mentioned in a conversation he had with Jules LaBelle, who will come after me, and I'll be speaking fast because you really want to hear the legal aspects of this, and I don't want to run out of time. He said, we're really looking at this backwards, because in humans, we really all start in enriched environments rather than the few cases of European orphanages and the like. And then we isolate people. We don't start in isolation and then put people into enrichment, which is what we were doing. And as I say on a poster tomorrow that we have tomorrow morning, A to B in this case does not equal B to A. And so so we started asking these questions. And, you know, as said here, I think is it, there is it, human beings, we are social animals. And I want to make the case that not only humans, but all mammals, and now locusts, are are social animals, because I did not know the social aspects of invertebrates. And it has been mentioned that in this case, people who live in isolated conditions, and it has been described, have lots of documented psychiatric issues, including depression and stress, which Huda talked about, and the sequela that comes from that. I'm not going to go through this because Michael did, but this is sort of what the pictures of the solitary confinement cells, and as he said, at this time, on today, there's approximately 80,000 people sitting in these solitary conditions. And as I said, it's important to realize that rodents, like humans, are social creatures. When you move them into isolated conditions, their behaviors change. Huda talked about the vocalizations, but their other behaviors change also. And there's actually articles going like this one: no one likes to live alone, social housing in lab animals. So the question is, how do we go about replicating this? And so I've sort of started to look at areas. So social research said that humans need about 150 square foot for their mental health. Okay, so just going into the correction system and putting into the size of the cells, they are given half of the square footage that is documented to be necessary for mental health. So San Diego here right now, if you take all of the area of San Diego and all the people here, not including the 30-some thousand of us now included in this, there's about 737 square foot for people. The most populous place in the country is Dhaka in Bangladesh. There it's still 173 square feet for people. So we try to replicate that and say, well, how do we give this an animal? So what we've done is, there it is. We have these enriched environments here. So this is a cage that's a meter by a meter. So they're very large. They're filled with tunnels. They have places to exercise. And we raise animals. They're born in here, and we have multi-generations of animals that go in here. Now, at a certain point, we have to pull them out so that for all of us who work with mice and don't wean quick enough, that they don't constantly keep getting pregnant. So we cull this down to a large number of animals of either males or females, and then we let them go to adulthood. And at 3 months of age, so young adults, we move them into what the rest of us call standard caging, which is isolation in a rack system, so they can still see each other, they can vocalize with each other, they just don't have the physical interactions. And this is very similar to the effects that are seen in the corrections department in cells. I put this in here for the non-neuroscientists, but I can. These are the things we're looking at: dendrites, cell body, and axons, and the effects there. And I can skip that one pretty fast for this audience. What we're doing here, though, is the way we're doing it, and I want to give a shout out to Vibal Hang, who's in the first row here. This is his thesis work in my lab. And so what he's doing now is, in this study, is we take the brains, we put them from the enriched environments there, we raise them for several months, and then we put them into isolation. And we're looking right now at two points: 30 days after isolation and 90 days after isolation. We then take the animals, we do Golgi staining of these cells so that we can visualize the entire neurons there, and then looking at both intracortical cells as well as projection neurons from the cortex, we do the Golgi analysis, we do a 3D reconstruction of these neurons, and then we either put bounding boxes around them to look at the areas, or we measure the lengths of the dendrites, the number of branching in these cells, and all this that happens at 1 month of age. And so all of this data is unpublished, and some of it is less than a week old. So. And so you're hearing a lot of this just for the first time. So what we have found is 1 month of isolation does not cause any significant changes in the individual parameters of the axon size or the dendrite length and like. But overall, if you put bounding box, we get about a 20% significant reduction of neuronal volume. This is 1 month of isolation in both sensory and motor cortices. Okay, we get. A small change, non-significant change at 1 month in the amount of branching. But the interesting point to us was, despite this reduction in volume, which you can imagine 20% of all these neurons trying to communicate with us, the spine counts went up about 17%. And so we were really fascinated by this because it suggests that 1 month, the cells are trying to compensate for the loss of volume in the protection connections by upregulating by about the same amount the spine number. So at 1 month, there's still all this sort of plasticity going on and the reaction to this change. And this was really unexpected because we expected to see a decrease or no change in the spine. However, when you go by 3 months, okay, so now 90 days isolated, we now get significant changes in all the individual parameters. So there's a change in dendritic size, length. There's a change in the axon length. We get changes now in branching, in significant decrease in branching. We still have the loss of volume of the cell, but now, interesting, the spines have reduced. So the compensatory period is over, because it's probably the use it or lose it kind of effects there, so they can't keep making these connections, so they don't get the trophic support of all the connections. And those extra supernumerary spines that were made have reduced bounds, so now we're down to the 20% loss of spines that equals the 20 or 25% loss of volume. And so that success at 3 months, which is all the iacuc is allowing us to keep the animals in isolation. We can't go longer than that. And that suggests, you know, so the iacuc is saying 3 months is just as long as you can go, but for people it can be 29 years or 40 years or the like. And so other results we have that were alluded to, like BDNF levels in the brain. Now this is a little bit of a different study. This was a study where we did this adults. We took as adults from enriched environment and moved them to isolation rather than raising them in isolation. And so here, BDNF is way down in the brain. Cortisol levels are up and down also, depending on what part of the brain you're in, if you're in the hippocampus or in the serum. And interestingly, looking at mitochondrial damage and DNA repair is significantly reduced. And these were studies that were done in Michael Zygmunt's lab and in collaboration with Laurie Sanders when she was at the University of Pittsburgh. So sort of to conclude here, within 1 month of isolation, neurons in the motor cortex are reduced about 20%, also in the sensory. It progresses through 3 months. Isolation starting in adulthood reduces neurotrophic levels, cortisol levels, and increases DNA damage or the DNA repair mechanisms are decreased. And the important question that we're trying to answer now is this loss permanent or is it able to be reversed? And so we've done we're in the process of doing the experiments where we have taken the animals after 3 months and reintroduced them into an enriched environment to ask whether this is important and this is permanent. And so we don't know the answer. And based on conversations with people who have spent long times in solitary confinement, all of them suggest that the changes, while can be mediated, are probably permanent, at least in people they are. The implications of our study are probably going to be dependent on where we look because of the functional lateralization and specification of different areas of the brain. So we've looked in motor cortex and sensory cortex now. We will be looking in frontal cortex, which then might impact executive decisions. As Huda talked about, we'll be looking at hippocampus and hippocampal size and the like. And, you know, and all of these will have different effects, and we don't know if we'll see the same thing or different or effects, but we'll be looking in each part of these the brains here. And so I do want to say one thing. So with Robert here, and there's two other people in our audience, Jack Morris and Dolores Gonzalez, who have spent time in solitary confinement. And it's, you know, I have, in spending time and talking to them, we sort of remove ourselves from the ivory tower and listen to the experiences that they have. And their experiences really are leading us to ask the questions. We are not driving this research. It is the research that is being driven by the experience of humans that have been in this condition. And I urge any of you not working in this, but if you're working in other fields, if you're working in Parkinson's disease like I do, or Alzheimer's, leave the laboratory. Talk to people who have the conditions that you're studying, because it's, you know, it's really important to get their perspective sort of to leave your research. So anyway, thank you.
Beautiful study, Bill Mobley, UCSD. So the early signature was a trophic deficit. You had a smaller brain. Mm-hmm. I wonder if, in fact, one could anticipate even that one-month measure by measures of BDNF gene expression even earlier, even after days.
We want to do that. Right now, we're taking the sort of the 3,000-foot view here. We've also started an epigenetic study where we're asking these early changes and at earlier points. So we're asking about epigenetic changes and the like. But yeah, no, I expect to see that we would probably see these trophic effects way earlier than any changes that you'd see in structural.
And you know, following on Huda's comment, maybe changes in trophic levels ought to serve as a biomarker to convince whoever we need to convince that this is really having an effect on brain function. Even limited periods of isolation could be dangerous on the basis of valid biomarkers that we could measure.
Would you be on study section?
That's a tall order. I'd like to be in that case.
Yes.
Hi, amazing panel, by the way. I'm shocked that SFN initially rejected it, so I hope the crowd size shows that this was an excellent panel. A feeling that in the human studies and Robert's story that seems to be getting mixed in here is boredom. And it seems that with Robert's answer about kind of contextualizing his solitary confinement and giving himself a sense of purpose, if you will, to fight for his humane treatment, it kind of reminded me of the other kinds of social isolation. If we think of astronauts going to space or the early explorers out on ships, that the sense of purpose could be possibly mixing in and becomes resilience and might help with the effects of loneliness. And I'm even thinking with animals with contra-freeloading, where they prefer to work for their own food than to just be handed it. Are there any studies where we're kind of looking at, maybe with Stephanie's studies, kind of the sense of purpose helping with loneliness in that way? I'm thinking in terms of maybe ameliorating things like the effects of solitary confinement.
I just want to say there have been studies of POWs who were held in solitary confinement, and they found that the POWs who did the best were those who had a purpose of resisting their confinement, or, you know, resisting against the enemy. And they're the ones who psychologically performed the best in those circumstances. John McCain, I think, being one of them. I don't think he was part of the study, but I think that's part of it.
You know, I do think that understanding mechanisms of resilience that occur under the variety of conditions would really be helpful, both in helping people, but also in our recasting the way we ask questions about how the brain copes, because this is all about coping, and that's the job of the brain, right? And so there's different styles. Some people have an active coping style, some use anger to good purpose, and some use generosity to good purpose. And so as long as you don't feel powerless, so if we remember the definition of stress, which is loss of control, loss of predictability, how do you change that? How do you gain control? And how do you gain some level of predictability? And how do you invent that for yourself? And how does the world help you do that?
Yes. Thank you for your talk today. So my question is, can you comment on what the microglia or astrocytes are doing in response to the isolation or just in response to the dendritic changes in these areas that you looked at?
No. We got the anatomy a week ago. We have the sections. We are going to be looking at that. So everything is cut. All the brains are there, but we have not done the IBA or GFAP staining. But and also, we're going to be looking at peripheral cytokine eventually, too. So asking about the peripheral immune signaling into the brain.
So can I just say that in the depressed brains, when you look at whole genome gene expression, whole transcriptome gene expression, and you ask what is the biggest single finding, it's what's so-called cell type balance. And that is the proportion of markers for neurons versus glia, and the biggest loss is on the glia side.
Thank you.